Welcome to the North Pentecostal Church live stream, a place to be family.
1 Thessalonians 5, 16, 17, and 18 says, anyone? Rejoice always. We could just stop right there. Anybody rejoicing?
Mm-hmm.
You're supposed to be.
Always.
Always. Pray continually. Two things that you need to do for the rest of the day. Rejoice and pray. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Amen. We pray God's will for our lives, correct? And it says, rejoice always, pray continually, and give thanks in all circumstances. Is it easy to give thanks in all circumstances? I urge you to try it. It is not easy, but it's possible. I remember once, just once, I had a flat tire. Raining, thank you, Jesus. And I get a flat tire. It was back when Summer was in a baby seat. And I remember thinking, like, this really sucks. And I really didn't want to think about all the thank you for this. But everything that happened that night was literally a miracle. I mean, the rain stopped. A cousin happened to drive by and pull over and, Becky, you need some help? Yes, please. An aunt drives by. Do you want me to take Summer with me to my house until you're done? Yes, please. Hello? Yeah. Even
that's what helps when you're related to everybody. I'd be sitting there all night.
You know what? I'm thankful I'm related to everybody. The next time you're like, come on, are you serious? Try to think of something positive, and I promise you, you will find more than one thing. Rejoice always. Pray continually and give thanks in all circumstances, because that is God's will for your life. Amen. And we shall invite the pastor. Everyone, Pastor Larry. Woohoo! Is he shaking his head at me?
I was just going to say.
Oh, and his new haircut! Yay!
I'll just add to that, since Becky has now preached my entire message, I'm going to lead worship today.
Oh, no.
No. No.
I love how there's a lot of no's. Thanks for the confidence. We have a couple of announcements to get through. We have a video announcement regarding our Givetober. So that is your reminder that we are in October, which we have for the last few years designated as Givetober. It's an opportunity for you to take a look at the two major needs that we are kind of highlighting, the first one being Kyrgyzstan and the coal that came up last week. And there's other things involved in that. There's always groceries and everything that we can supply with people over there. And today we're going to see a video about Haiti, but we wanted to just remind you that if you are giving towards that, you just have to write down Givetober, or you can write coal, or you can write Haiti, and we'll make sure that that's designated 100% to where it is that you want to give your offering during this month in that section. So the box is just out by the coffee bar. If you've passed it on the way through, that's where it is. We're not obviously doing the passing of the collection plates right now. That's just a better way to collect the money and make sure everyone is safe and allow for you to continue to bless God in what you do. So I'm going to ask Kevin, I know the sound is already set, so if you want to just click on that Blessing Haiti and we'll watch that video.
Jésus, c'est où qui t'es, et où sauver,
So we know, as a church, those who have been involved or have seen that it's been happening, one of the major things that Gordon Diane do for Haiti is they pack up the barrels. In this last month or so, you've been doing entire containers with food, with supplies, blankets, things like that, that have been shipped over to help support those in need. So that's some of the areas that you're giving towards Haiti go in order to help support what is going on the ground over there. This video will be online as well as the one from last week. If you want to review those, take a look, remind yourself, pray over them, pray for the faces of the people you see, Pastor Spencer, others, and just do that by name as you walk through your daily prayer time. That would be a great exercise. We want to move on to a different announcement. In the coming weeks, and Jen has talked about it, but Freedom Session is beginning. And so this is something that can be very crucial to many people. If you were at the graduation service or a part of it in the summer, you will know that it is a major thing for people to come through on the other side, to find freedom from things, to find that sense of we've overcome. And so if that is something that you'd like to do, you'll need to get in touch with Jen soon to sign up because it's coming quickly.
This Tuesday, we start at 6:30 at the Havelock Center. You don't have to commit until week three, so you can come out for a couple weeks or whatever and just check it out and see if you're interested, see what it's all about. So this Tuesday at 6:30, Havelock Center.
There you go. So if you just want the quick information, you can come out on Tuesday at 6:30 and see exactly what's going on. And then after the third week, you need to commit to it, and it is quite a few months, but it is well worth the investment into your own life. And so I do invite each of you, if you're interested, please go out Tuesday night at 6:30 and find out exactly what it is. Lastly, in announcements right now, and we'll come later. I know some of you have seen Evan, and last week Pastor Larry had one of those like, I don't know what happened, and he never told you about the baby. And some of you already knew, and that's fine. He's going to come before the message and share a little bit of that, not too much, because I've seen the photo of the aftermath. But Dr. Evan will come later and share, because I forgot. Just straight up forgot. But we wanted to give an incredible thank you to each one who invested yesterday. If you spent time, if you came and performed, if you volunteered, if you launched pumpkins and laughed your head off the entire time they flew through the air, we are so thankful for you. I mean, like, regardless of the capacity that you feel, oh, I only did a small amount, it was huge yesterday. We had a few hundred people pass through that were not churched, that were thankful for the opportunity to come through. It was an interesting moment. I'm going to take a little bit of time with this because it is Thanksgiving. But we had an interesting couple of weeks leading up to it where we had people that were committed and food vendors and all of this opportunity, and we ran into snag after snag with different items, with protocols, with things that we couldn't have any handle on. And then one of our food vendors got sick the night before and they couldn't come. And so we had one food vendor who had a couple hundred sales go through that otherwise their weekend would have been for zero. And so it actually was God's blessing on that moment to be able to do that. And even with the weather, we still had people come through. We still found a way to do music. Not by my own insight, but by those who served in that music field. They knew exactly where to put for cover and did it out in the front. And people sat and watched, and it was amazing. So on behalf of Pastor Solomon, Nicole, Pastor Evan, Jamie, myself, all of those who were involved in the planning and getting it together, thank you so much for being there and for being a part of it. And we still have a bunch of pumpkins that are going to get launched with our youth. And so if you know youth who want to come out and later this month and launch the pumpkins, that sign-up is going to be available soon, and it would be huge for them to be here and to decorate and then see how far they can launch it and win a prize. We didn't give away prizes last night or yesterday, but Pastor Evan's going to give away prizes for that. So it'll be huge and different. And then in KFC, Pastor Solomon's going to do some decorating, and we've got some set up for decorating, and there's a lot more out there. And so they'll be available after all of that. If you want to take one to feed the wildlife and use it for bait for hunting or something, you're more than welcome after Halloween to do so. Just saying, there's a lot of pumpkins. Or if you just want to take them and cook the seeds, that's up to you as well.
Or a pumpkin pie?
That's, well, sure. I saw, I don't know, I think it was Jess who shared the photo, the correct way to eat pumpkin pie. And it was just all Cool Whip, and then there was a little piece of pie under it. I'm all about pumpkin pie like that. That's awesome. Let's invite ourselves at this point and the Spirit to come and be in this place. Stand with us as we jump into an incredible moment of worship. Father, thank you that you have brought us here in this moment to bless us, to be a part of this day, to surround us by your mercies and your presence. We thank you, Lord, also for Doug, who at this moment is down in Ennismore, and he's supporting another church to have worship today. And we pray in that, Lord, that it would be an incredible blessing, both to Doug and Ken, who were there, but also to the church.
Yes.
God, have your way in that assembly today, just as you will in this place. We set aside our agenda, we set aside our timeline, we set aside our lives, that you would come and move in power among your people. We give you thanks for all that you're about to do and for just simply who you are. In Jesus' name, amen.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Outstretched arm, his love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, his love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Setting sun, his love endures forever, and by the grace of God, we will carry on. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise,
sing praise,
sing,
sing praise. Forever God is with us. Shaking hands, hugging, hi, how's it going? I want you to turn around and I want you to wave and smile with your eyes at people around you, okay? This is church. You're supposed to be enjoying yourself. Okay, turn around. Everyone wants to see you. They don't want to see me. Too bad. Do you feel better? Do it again if you're not better yet. All right, let's keep going. Enjoying the praise this morning? A little bit more?
Of course.
We've waited for this day. We've gathered in your name, calling out to you. Thank you, Jesus. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason we're here.
He is.
You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens. We want to see you. Open up the floodgates. The mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise.
Sing that again. Open up the heavens.
Open up the heavens. We want to see you. Open up the floodgates.
floodgates, the mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Your presence in this place, your glory on our face, looking to the sky, descending like a cloud, you're standing with us now, Lord, unveil our eyes. You're the reason we're here, you're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise.
Open up the heavens.
Open, open up the heavens. We want to see you. Open up the floodgates, the mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Show us your glory, show us your power, show us your glory, Lord.
Show us, Lord.
Show us your glory, show us your power, show us your glory, Lord.
Show us your glory.
Show us your glory, show us your power, show us your glory, Lord. Show us your glory, show us your power, show us your glory, Lord. A mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise.
Open up the heavens.
Open up the heavens.
Yes.
We want to see you. Open up the floodgates. The mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise.
Show us your glory, Lord.
Show us your glory, show us your power, show us your glory, Lord.
We're ready,
show us your glory, show us your power, show us your glory, Lord.
Sing that again one more time.
Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord.
Thank you,
Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
From the moment that I wake up, yeah, till I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Sing that again. I love you, Lord.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me all my days.
I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been. I've known you as a father,
yeah.
I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God.
Yeah.
All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so is running after,
yes,
it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after. All my life you have been faithful,
yes, Lord.
And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Of the goodness of God. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, we worship you.
Thank you, Lord.
You are right. Thank you.
The world, but it couldn't fill me. And man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough.
Yes.
Then you came along,
yes,
and put me back together. Is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing
the God of the valleys. It's the God of the valleys.
Sorry, that was mountain.
And there's not a place your mercy and grace won't find me again. Shame into glory. You're the only one who can.
You turn my morning into dancing.
You turn morning to dancing. You give beauty from ashes.
You turn shame into glory.
Into glory, yes. You're the only one who can.
Sing that again. You turn morning to dancing.
You turn morning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can.
You turn graves into gardens.
You turn graves into gardens. You turn bone into armies. Turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can.
Sing that again. Graves into gardens.
You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can.
You turn morning into dancing.
You turn morning to dance.
Do you get it this morning?
You turn beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. Turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. Oh, there's nothing,
yes,
better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing. Nothing is better than you.
Sing that again. Oh, there's nothing better.
Oh, there's nothing is better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing. Nothing is better than you.
Lord, the proper response at this time is one of hallelujah. To know that in this world, in this life, there is nothing that compares. That even the simple utterance of your name would tear down strongholds, would remove all that would come against. Jesus, that you stand far above all things. And in our lives, the declaration, Lord, today is that there is none like you. That you are able to take everything in our life and use it for good. And you do that constantly. And Father, we can trust that whenever we come to you with heavy burdens, with things in our lives that are weighing us down, that you are there to receive them. So Jesus, we bring you glory today. We thank you that you're the only one that matters. And though there's things in our lives that we care and love deeply, that when in proper perspective, you are the only one that matters. So Father, as we move to look into your word, to continue talking about supernatural weapons that you have given us and invited us to use, Father, I pray that you are blessed in this time and that you speak to each one of us. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. You know, the interesting thing about that song, Graves in a Gardens, is that we often think just about the timeline of Jesus' death and the tomb and the resurrection and everything in there, but there are moments in your life when you actually take a second and step back and overview everything, you will recognize that there are graves that fill your life that you can look at and say, Jesus, come and take this, redeem it, restore it, and it becomes a garden of life. And it's incredible to know that that is who our God is, and that's who he wants to be for each one of us. Before we dismiss our kids, I'm going to ask our new doctor to come. I'm going to bother him about this forever. I hope he doesn't get a big head about it, but Evan's going to tell us about his life.
Hi. So the rumors are true about our daughter. Whatever you've heard, even if it didn't actually happen, it's true. And we can build this into an urban legend. That would be great. Our daughter was born last Monday, September 27th, and we didn't quite make it to the hospital, so yours truly had to get on the phone with 911 and deliver our baby. Which is very meaningful and also very terrifying. I would not recommend it. That being said, if anyone is in trouble and you need a baby delivered, we're just in Havelock, so give us a shout and I'll help you out any way I can. Probably just cry with you on the phone. No, anyway. Mom and baby are doing well. They're at home right now. We're still kind of in the sleepless stage of everything, but we're very, very thankful that despite all the circumstances, Rose is happy and healthy and is all her vitals are good. She's growing and feeding well and stuff. And so we really appreciate your prayers and support as we've gone through that. So thank you. Yeah, that's kind of the latest life announcement for me. 4 years ago now, in September, was it 4 years ago? I think it was. It was 3 or 4 years ago now. As many of you know, I started on a journey of getting my master's in counseling psychology to pursue registration as a psychotherapist in Ontario. And a lot of that had to do, this is before we even had kids, but we were certainly talking about it, and we had kind of decided that we wanted to avoid daycare as much as possible, just as our kind of personal decision. And so that meant Leah would have to stop working and I would have to find a way to supplement her income. Plus, it was something I'd always wanted to do. I loved studying, and I always wanted to get my master's degree. And it also would have supported my work here as well, working with students and getting to kind of be that support to them. It allowed me to do that better than I could have before. So all those three reasons led us to decide that I was gonna do this, I was gonna pursue it. And on May 14th, I graduated, got my degree. And was able actually to sign a part-time contract with the clinic I did my placement at. So that was really great because we were always, you know, the big question is, okay, how long is it between graduating and actually getting work in the field? And that window was very short. It was very immediate. And as I got to practice and as I got to do it, it quickly became something I got very passionate about and very excited about. I love that opportunity to get to sit one-on-one. I actually work primarily with teenagers at the clinic, and so get to sit with them and have these really, really important conversations and get to work through some of the really heavy stuff that they're going through gets me very excited and very fulfilled. And so recently, I have had an opportunity to join an organization called Youth Hab in Belleville. They provide free counseling services for people ages 16 to 24, and they do a lot of work with transitional housing and a few other services. And that is also a part-time contract. And so when the opportunity came up, it was a lot of thought and a lot of prayer, but we decided to send my resume in and apply for the job, and I ended up getting the job, and I'll be starting in November, which means that my time as the youth pastor here at Norwood Pentecostal Church will be coming to an end on October 31st. So I have so treasured being the minister for all the students here that I've had the privilege to serve and to walk with, to pray with, to go to remote locations with no running water, and all those kinds of pieces. It's really been an honor, and it still is something I'm doing in kind of a different sense in my new roles here as a counselor and as a therapist. But we so appreciate the opportunity and the honor that it's been to serve the church and the young people here at Norwood Pentecostal Church. That being said, what we've also found is because we started here, it'll be 4 years in March, so we're about 3 years and change now. What we found as well is we didn't just find a place of employment, but we really did find a home. And so we have built some really key, significant relationships in our life. And so while my time as youth pastor is coming to an end, we still intend on making this our home church, still attending and serving just in kind of a different capacity here at the church. So we're not going anywhere. And so I apologize if you were hoping we were going somewhere. I don't know if I've made too many enemies, but if you're out there, we're still here. So we won't be leaving. We love it here, and again, just have really found an incredibly supportive, important, loving community that we would really regret leaving. And so again, while the role is changing, we still consider this our home church. We're still planning on attending, and we're still available to serve as the need arises. So again, I just wanted to say thank you for everything, for making this a home worth staying in. Like that's been an incredible experience, and it's been amazing getting to serve as your youth pastor. So thank you so much.
We're gonna take a moment and just pray over Evan before he heads down to his seat. I told Evan I got a chance to be one of those references for the new place, and I tried my best. I told him he's a horrible person. He should never be trusted to run away, and they still hired him. So that's not what I said. We're going to pray over him. It is something to be said about the church when multiple generations of pastors have come through here and have stuck around after their time was done, either in the town or at the church. And so the board, in presenting that to them on Thursday night about Evan's resignation and his desire to remain still in the town and a part of the congregation, were more than happy to extend that invitation to Evan and Leah and the girls. And we are excited to still build relationship, to remain in that function with him, and pour into his life as he continues to serve in this body. Join me as we just take a moment and pray over Evan. Father, I thank you for who Pastor Evan has been, for all that he has poured into this church, for the time that he has devoted not just to youth, but to families. Father, there is a lot to be said about simple moments and profound moments. And Lord, I know in these last 2 weeks, having filled in for him on Wednesdays and helping out on Fridays, there's a lot of energy that is expelled in an hour. And so, Father, I'm thankful for what he has done and for the legacy that is there in the lives of those he has deeply impacted. And I pray, Lord, that knowing he is remaining here, that there would still be opportunity to walk with people as they need to, but in that distance as provided with those who, whoever it is that comes in to this role. Father, I thank you for this church that is has loved and accepted him and is inviting in that to allow them to remain as a part of this body and this community and to continue to mentor and grow his life and his faith as well. And so, Father, we bless him in this new role. We miss him in what he's in right now, but know that you will still use him in mighty, incredible ways. And so, Father, we pray your spirit heavy upon him, that you would use him in profound ways for the kingdom, to draw many towards you, even in whatever sense of therapy and counseling that it is, that you would use his gifts and skills as a believer to bring people close to your heart. And so, Lord, we pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, Evan. There will, of course, be a couple of weeks still to give thanks to him, to bless him, and we're trying to think of a kind of ingenious way to support and send him off well as a farewell at the end of October. Obviously, the potluck thing is not going to happen, but we're trying to figure out something that we can do in that. At this time, I'll invite all of the children who are heading off to Super Church and to preschool to make their way out this door or that door and head to your classrooms. And we'll jump in. Have fun over there. Just as a reminder for those who were here last week, those who haven't heard yet, we are in a series about the supernatural, and in the last series I quoted the scripture that says it's not against flesh and blood that we are in war against. We do not battle against one another, but against the principalities and powers that are at work within the dark world. Now that's paraphrased, but that's the idea of where we're coming from in this. And in that, as we look through scripture and as we look at our own lives, there are things that God has empowered us with, which we use on a daily basis, that we might not understand the power behind them. That he's given them to us as practices, and we maybe negate them because we think they're just simple things that we're supposed to do or their duties. But they actually have supernatural power behind them. So last week we talked about worship. This week, obviously, it's Thanksgiving, so you know where we're going. And then we've got a couple of more that we're going to handle in the weeks ahead. But it's that sense that there is more to life and the things that we do than just simply uttering words and doing simple everyday actions. I want to take a moment and say my own thank yous. I'm going to take advantage of Thanksgiving all I want today. It is almost 2 years to the day for us that we came. We started on Thanksgiving weekend. It was the first Sunday we were in here. I didn't preach that day, but it was the first Sunday we attended. Then we went over to the fair, and then on the Tuesday I came into office, and I sat down with staff, and we got to do things, and I met people, and Bev walked me through the path of Journey, and we talked about what Journey to Bethlehem is and how we were going to take care of the field and put the work in and make sure it's all possible. And then I got sick and ended up in the hospital that day, and the doctor told me I was dying. What an awesome segue that was, right? Bev came that night and prayed over me and over the whole situation, and it was something to be thankful for, and I don't remember much of it because whatever kind of pain med they gave me, apparently I said some weird things to doctors and nurses, so I don't know. I don't remember much. But I'm thankful for the healthcare, and I'm thankful for the church who rose up and prayed in that moment, and for Bev coming to visit. And this is where we're at now. I also say thank you to the staff who over the last 2 years, and obviously there's been some change continues to kind of move. They have been the most supportive staff that I could ask for. They've been incredible to stand by, to put wisdom in where it needs to mentor in areas. It's been amazing working with the staff, with the board that we've had, with all forms of leadership, you as volunteers. It's been a great blessing. It's been amazing, and I love that this is a place that we call home, and that hopefully it's something we do for many years ahead in this role, and who knows how long we'll be here in this role. I hope it's a long time. My pastor in Smiths Falls always had a joke that you'd have to put him in the retirement home when he's done, and he's getting close to that. So maybe it wasn't a joke. But I thank you for all that you've been for us to make this our home, to be inviting, to be welcoming, to be loving and supportive. It's been incredible, and we continue to push in and see what God wants to do. Obviously, 2 years has been upside down because we had about 5 months of, okay, we're getting to know people, and we still don't know everyone, and there's faces in here that I look and I say, I don't know if you're new or if you've attended for 30 years, but I don't know you. But that was the nature of coming in and then shutting down. And so we push in, and hopefully we get to know you all soon, and hopefully this passes so we can fill this place again and get the gospel out into the town in strong, incredible ways like we did yesterday. So today we're looking at thankfulness, how a grateful heart or personality can become a weapon in the supernatural that God has given us. And so as we go through this, we're going to read 3 verses today. They're going to be on screen. You can turn in your Bible if you want to, but I'm going to read them in succession. They're not huge because I wanted them all on one slide. So if you want to go through each one, you're welcome to, but I'm going to read them just as they are, starting with Philippians and then moving on from there. Philippians 4, verses 4 to 7 says, "Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." And then in Ephesians 5, the second part of 18 into 20, it says, "Instead, be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another with psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit. Sing and make music from your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks to God the Father for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ." And in Colossians 3, verses 15 and 17, it says, "Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body, you were called to peace, and be thankful. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him." Again, this week as last, the way I want to handle this is to give you a brief idea of the main theme behind these passages so that when we get to the application, you have an understanding of why it's important that we express thanksgiving in all situations and how it then becomes a weapon in our hands in the heavenly realm. There is a progression of thought here, and it's very persuasive in all of the writings of Paul. But as you read through his letters, you come to understand that a lot of it links back to one another. Different churches, different timelines, different culture settings, and even different contexts. But we come to understand in our context that what Paul wrote almost 2,000 years ago still is absolutely applicable in every way today. And so there is this sense that his themes bleed into one another, and it's very relevant in every timeline. So as we read this, we keep in mind that the theme we cover is covered well by Paul, and you would do well to yourself to read all of his letters and see how much he talked about thanksgiving and why it's important to, in all things, give thanks. So looking at Philippians 4 briefly, it's when I was recording or researching this passage, something I found incredibly interesting about what was written in commentaries and in scholarly books about this passage is that that section up there that says, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, in all of the major commentaries out there, that is covered by no one. There is literally nothing in any commentary I own or any I could find online that said anything about coming in prayer with thanksgiving. And I was stumped, and I thought, isn't that one of the most important things to know that Paul is saying, as you pray, do it in thanks, not just, well, just pray, but do it in thanksgiving. And then, so I turned towards a cultural commentary, and that's where I actually began to see something that brought this to life a little bit for me. So when Paul begins the passage, he says, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. He repeats the word, and it gives clear definition of the importance of a life of continual rejoicing. It's meant to highlight for the reader of that timeline and now ours that by living in this turnover of joy into joy into joy, you are demonstrating that you have total confidence in God. The consistency of one's rejoicing in God shows their trust for Him to care for them in every situation they ever face. And so when it says rejoice in the Lord, again I say rejoice, He is saying in that moment, in everything you do, rejoice. We might know another verse that says, count everything joy. Paul is echoing that in this sense. And then as he says to the reader, pray in every situation with thanksgiving, there's an echo to it in that. When you pray with a heart of gratitude, you are saying to God, here is my need. Here is my situation. Here is the desire that I have in my heart. And I thank you, God, that you hold all things and that you are able to handle anything and everything that I bring to you. Paul then backs it up by telling us that when we come to prayer, there is a, with that spirit of thanksgiving, that the peace of God will then fill our hearts. It will cover us, and it will protect our hearts and our minds. So I think often what happens is we get anxious about something, and we say something, maybe a quick prayer like, oh God, help. I don't know what to do. Yesterday morning, that was kind of my prayer. As we sat there and it started to rain and we had all of these things set up that some had to be canceled last minute, and I went, God, help. Like I was really indecisive. And He stepped in through the voice of someone else. But we reach that moment and we get anxious, and maybe we say a prayer, maybe we say something else that I'm not going to repeat from the stage. But we say something in that moment of anxiety, and instead of focusing on God's goodness and His ability to be trusted, we focus on the stress factor. We focus on the thing that is bringing us anxiety, and that becomes forefront in our mind. And instead of God's goodness, all we're thinking about now is what's causing us stress. It is the moment of thanks that makes the difference for us. In this culture we live in today, we can see that how thankful we are in a season is actually tied to the joy that we have in our lives. They actually reflect one another, and they create the matching sense within the person. And so when you rejoice, which is showing a sense of joy over someone or something, it can create a spirit of thankfulness within your heart. And giving thanks can create joy in your life as well. There is a working of the supernatural in this as God moves in our trust of Him, and He secures it in our lives by sending His incredible peace to guard us. And I remind you in this, the key to this verse are the words always, rejoice always, and with, prayer with thanksgiving. We'll move to Ephesians. Paul is telling the church here about the proper way to give, to live as one who follows Jesus. In this direct context of these verses, he has just said to be wise and understand the Lord's will and to not get drunk on wine. And then he goes and he says, instead, be filled with the Spirit. And he begins to list activities like speaking to one another with psalms and songs of the Spirit. Did you know that when you sing, it's actually just speaking to the Lord in his words? It's just declaring to Him that He's good, in his own language. And when we speak to one another in hymns and in songs of the Spirit and in psalms, we are speaking the words of God to one another. And so it's important to carry that out. But now he's adding to it, sing from your heart and always give thanks to God for everything. So he employs an image here of characteristic Christianity. Those things, those practices, which should be characteristic of all of us who believe. The practices listed are stereotypical of the timeline when he wrote this letter. Any who came to the temple would enjoy a moment of worship where they sing psalms or hymns, or they chant the psalms typically. But then they would leave with that in their heart and their mind, and they would continue to sing or to chant that psalm, and it would remain with them through the day. Paul then included something that had not been taught much on, and it's maybe new to the people of the time. Make music from your heart. This is what differentiated the traditional view of music from the Spirit-led form. It was believed that all music is inspired. Everything that the believers sang was inspired by the Spirit, but when Paul gives the instruction to sing from their heart, what he's saying is, use the voice of the Spirit. A Spirit-led song, not just inspired, but led by the Spirit. Now, we have this term, do what your heart feels. Follow your heart. However, that's not actually the proper way to do this, and that's not what Paul's talking about here, because when we say follow your heart, well, we also know the heart is deceitful, that center of emotions. What Paul is saying in here is listen to where the Spirit is and sing that song from him. And it's important to acknowledge this because Paul's next words are an indicator of a person who is led by the Spirit. Always give thanks to God the Father. In the name of Jesus. Paul and all of those who are reading this letter understand that the Spirit lives within their heart. This is the place he dwells. And so when he speaks to the heart. And so they're not going, follow your heart. They're going, follow the Spirit. And give thanks, because that's what the Spirit is doing. He's telling the church that one who hears the voice of the Spirit will sing the songs within their hearts and will always in everything give thanks. Now, when you take this passage and tie it to the one in Philippians, what you begin to see is a structure of thanksgiving. Because it is God who gives all things that we come in gratitude at all times, and including those psalms and hymns. Because it is God we bring our prayers to, we give thanks to him for our prayers, in our prayers, at all times, because he is good. It's the sense of gratitude that then makes waves in the heavenly realms. And I'll show you how shortly, but it is important to know that this practice is one which is uncommon in the world, but it should be very common in the church, that in all things we begin to give thanks. There's a popular saying, and some of you have said it, and some of you know it, and you put it on your social media, and it was in my office when I moved into it, and it was in the main office. I don't know if it's still up, but it's, imagine if you woke up tomorrow with only the things you gave thanks for today. What would your life be like if that was the case? If tomorrow morning you woke up with only what you gave thanks for today, shockingly, some of you would wake up tomorrow with not even breath. Some of you tomorrow morning would wake up with more in your life than you went to bed for today, because you understand the power of thankfulness, of gratitude, that spirit of thanksgiving. You understand the difference and what it means to stand in thanks of all things. And though God is generous and he gives us more than we are thankful for, it would be a good practice to begin today to give thanks more and more. As we move toward the two verses in Colossians, I want to let you know that the first two that we looked at were an individual basis. In Philippians and in Ephesians, Paul is speaking to the individual. In Colossians, he's speaking to the church. When we read this, and I'm going to read it again, you need to understand that this statement is given as the corporate body, not as you as an individual, though it's very applicable. This is given as the corporate sense. Read it again with in mind that this speaks to the body of the church as a whole. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace, and be thankful. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. So the understanding should be that he is preaching to or teaching the whole church that you need to continually, as a body, give thanks. Yes, as individuals, but when you come together, do so in unison. If you notice, the interior issue that Paul's dealing with here is unity. We can know this because the reference to the words, the peace of Christ, almost always in Scripture speaks towards the peace of Christ as the unity which comes in the body. This is only alluded to here, but if you read through Ephesians, and maybe specifically chapter 2, verses 14 to 22, you will come to see that the peace of Jesus brings us through his death on the cross, through his resurrection from the grave, the reconciliation to the Father, and then that we are being built together as the dwelling place of the Spirit of God. And so in this sense, when we read these words and be thankful, there is a conclusion that has to be made. Corporate thankfulness, which is actually far too often overlooked, including by myself, is not just an outcome of unity. When you are unified, you will give thanks for the fact that you are unified and things are flowing well. But did you know that thankfulness in your heart and in the body of Christ is actually a requirement to reach unity? If you are not able to give thanks one to another and with each other, you will never reach a state of being unified as a body of Christ. So not only does it come from unity, but you have to have it in order to reach it. Paul dealt repeatedly with the issues which created disunity. Things like discord, dissension, factions, other items. Each one of these can be defeated when the body as one comes to give thanks, because the people are then able to overlook the faults of one another. It becomes easier to forgive petty or even major issues when we repent of our own sins and thank God for the person next to us. We know that unity in the body is the will of Jesus for the church, and in this the devil is quickly defeated. When the body is unified, the devil has no foothold. A spirit of thanksgiving is your supernatural weapon to bring about unity in the church and to wage war against the enemy. So here's a few ways that gratitude is a weapon. You can put that last slide up. First one is that it protects against the lies of the devil. When we are in a place of lacking gratitude in any way, we tend to be more open to the lies of Satan. When life is complaint-ridden, what tends to happen is in our hearts is a sense that God doesn't care about me. He's not near. He hasn't heard me. He won't give me what I need. He won't give me what I want. He's not going to be found. When all we do is complain, it's easy to look at the complaint and not focus on the goodness of God. Like a flat tire, which was a great illustration to open today. See, it could be big issues that we complain about, or it could be small things, which we turn into giant issues in our own minds. But when we complain about them, when we lose thankfulness, it becomes a place where the devil begins to lie. Two illustrations from Scripture. The first one, Adam and Eve in the garden. There's a very small issue in their life. God has told them that they can eat of any tree within the garden. From side to side, there are dozens, if not hundreds, or however many trees, and they are allowed to eat of every single one. Oh, but just one I want you to avoid. Can you imagine being in that place where let's say there's 200 trees and God says, you can eat of all 200 except for number 201. I want you to avoid that one tree. Just, it's there. Don't eat of it. But every other single tree, you can enjoy the bounty of it. And so Satan comes along knowing that he's going to pick on the one area that Eve is going to be a little bit tempted towards. And he says, isn't it true that God told you you couldn't eat of any tree? He twists the word of God. He lies to her. Isn't it true that God said you couldn't eat of any tree? Oh no, it's just the one. And he starts to spin it to the point where she's tempted and she hears the lie of the enemy. And she eats the fruit. And then Adam eats the fruit. What would it have been like if Eve hears those words? Isn't it true that God said you couldn't eat of any tree? And she says, no, you've got it wrong. And I thank God that it's wrong, because look at the bounty that he's given us. Look at these dozens, hundreds of trees that I get to consume every single day to my heart's desire and eat everything I want, just that one. And I don't care about just that one, because look at the rest. And I am so thankful for what he's given me. But she wasn't thankful, because he knew there's something in her that wants to eat of that one tree, instead of knowing that there's a clear bounty of many others. It was a small issue which she made large, and the devil exposed it. And if she had just given thanks, how long would humanity have lived in the garden, and how wide would it have stretched? Consider then, on the second side, or on the other side of this, the image of Jesus standing on the lake shore, surrounded by thousands of people as he's teaching them. And it's getting late in the night, and the disciples come and say, hey, Jesus, it's getting late. And these people are getting hungry. Send them away from us so they may eat. See, they're at that point where they're grumpy because they want their own food, and they're tired after a day of ministry, and they just want everyone to leave. They want everyone to get out. As a secondary illustration, not within my notes, but I find it funny that that's what they said. Send these people away, because yesterday, at the end of the day, when everything was said and done and I was getting grumpy and hungry, I looked at the staff that was here and I said, you guys good? Everything done? I think so. We can do stuff tomorrow. I said, good. Get out of the church. And it wasn't in like anger to get out, leave. It was go home. You need to rest. And also, I'm hungry. Can you just make your way so I can go home now? And then everyone was gone, and we stayed like another 20 minutes. I'm like, wow, I feel foolish now. But Jesus on the hillside, they come and they say, these people are hungry. And he, instead of saying the way, he says, feed them. You go feed them. There's thousands, 5,000 men and women. If you remember from last summer, we talked about it. And the estimate is actually, 5,000 men. The estimate is actually 20,000 people that would have been there. So he says, you go feed them. And so the disciples look around, and Andrew comes up to Jesus and says, we have 5 loaves of bread, which are not loaves, they're little biscuits, and 2 fish. And then he says, how far can this little go among so many, Lord? Only he doesn't say it with his inquisitive sense of wonder. He says it in absolute sarcasm. How far, Lord, can so little go among the masses? What are you going to do about this? Like, Jesus, this is a snack. What are we going to do about all this? And he's like, not mocking, but it's in total sarcasm. Lord, you know this isn't going anywhere. 2 people are going to eat this and it's going to be gone. And so Jesus looks at them and says, have all the people sit. And he takes the bread and he takes the fish and he lifts it in the air and he looks up at the clouds. And this is, understand, I know the first part's not real, but he looks and he says, really, God, this is all you're going to give me? Like, can you imagine if Jesus comes and not in thanksgiving, but he says, really, that's it? You're going to give me 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish? Like, Father, I thought I was doing your will. I can just feed a donkey with this. This is nothing. But he doesn't come in that sense of loss and complaint. He takes 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, and he lifts it to the heavens, and he gives thanks for it. He's filled with gratitude. God, look at this blessing that you have given this people today, knowing what he's about to do. Because Andrew sees the commonplace. Look at this small snack. And Jesus sees the miraculous. Andrew was leaning towards the deception of the moment. The Lord is here with us, and he wants us to feed 20,000 people with nothing. And Jesus sees abundance, because he came in gratitude. Because gratitude has the power to take what is given, no matter the simplicity of it, and make it simply amazing. This sense of thankfulness will protect you from the lies of the enemy who comes to persuade you that God is not watching out for you. So anytime you are gifted with something, whatever avenue that comes in, it doesn't have to be from somebody you know, whoever it is. It can be from somebody that you've never met. It can be in areas that you look at and you go, well, I don't want to trust this. Come in a moment of thanksgiving. Thank you, Lord, that you have blessed us with this so that we can, whatever needs to be done, see what God does with it. Because again, Andrew saw commonplace and he fell towards deception, and Jesus saw that if I give thanks for this, the Father will do incredible things with it. choose daily to give thanks, like Jesus did that day, to protect yourself from the devil's scheme and refuse to be deceived by his lies. And this leads well into the second one, that gratitude will guard your heart. Many of you know or are very familiar with Proverbs 4:23, in all things guard your heart, for it is a wellspring of life. Basically, everything you do comes from your heart. But have you ever paid attention to the verses before and after where other body parts are mentioned? In the verses leading up to verse 23, it talks about the ear and the eye, which is perceptivity. It allows things into the body to see and to hear what's happening. You can add to it even like the skin, because it allows that sense of touch and to know, you know, weather differences and so on. The nose, that he smells what's going on. And then the verses after verse 23, it talks about the feet, which guide, which travel, the eyes, which allow for direction, and the mouth, which speaks. These things which overflow from the heart. It would be good for us to understand that when that was written, that when that proverb was written, it's leading to understand in this, here's what comes in and here's what flows out, and it all centers on the heart. Everything we do comes from the heart, and if what is contained within your heart is not of the Spirit, we spew out acts of death and trouble. Gratitude will guard your heart. Where we know from earlier the Spirit resides within us, in our heart. And please know, I do not necessarily just mean the physical, though that probably is maintained here. But when we say the heart, when Scripture speaks of it, there's a little bit of leaning towards the spirit of the person, the soul of the person. That is where the Spirit makes his dwelling place. Not necessarily your physical blood-pumping heart, though as a person, certainly the Spirit is alive within there. If we don't guard our heart and we begin to let in things which do not honor God, we will see how the acts of the flesh begin to take over. Gratitude will not allow things like envy and strife to exist within us. It shields us from wanting to gravitate towards an unhealthy desire for other people's lives. Gratitude will not allow division to rise up. See, because as we thank God for the people around us, do you want to know what he begins to do? He begins to show us the blessing that somebody is to us that maybe we don't necessarily get along with too well. But if we give thanks for somebody who we enjoy being around, he'll begin to expose to us that the people that we don't so much enjoy are actually a huge blessing to us. But further, what he does is he shows how those people are an incredible blessing to him, which is probably a lot more important. The power of gratitude is so strong that when employed actively, any outside source is unable to rise within because of the sense of peace that will begin to dwell within you. Because when we give thanks in all things, we see how Paul is then able to say he can be content in all situations. He's not envious for the possessions of the rich. He doesn't long for the food of the wealthy when he was in need. But also, when life was going well for him, he did not hoard it away so nobody could have it. He was generous. And he did not flaunt that which he had so people would be jealous of him. He was content in all situations and at peace because of the power of this spirit of gratitude and what it afforded him to see all moments as a blessing from God. This was a part of Paul's testimony, and it can be yours as well. And gratitude actually carries its own testimony. You ever been offended by someone who says thank you? I don't mean like in that sarcastic manner, like you're walking into Tim Hortons and you don't think to look behind you and you let the door shut and they're like, hey, thanks for holding the door. I've been guilty of that at times. I've also been on the other end of it where people have looked and they saw that I was coming and they didn't hold the door and I wanted to say something so badly. But sarcasm often, if not always, is not the answer. But I mean like in genuine sense, thank you. Like maybe it's when you let someone in line in traffic in front of you or at Tim Hortons and they wave out their window like a real wave. I don't mean the other one. But they wave to say thank you. Or you take time if you're at Wendy's and you clean your table. You put your garbage away, you put the tray back instead of leaving it a mess. And the front counter staff is like, thanks for helping. I really appreciate it. And maybe you walk by someone on the street and you give them a meal. and they're just ecstatic and they emphatically thank you. These moments do not offend us, they bless us. And they speak to the character of the person behind them. One who recognizes they have been helped, blessed, guided, mentored, even warned and corrected when it's done right. Do you know you can thank people for correcting you? It's a great practice and helps you to be thankful for all things. Gratitude speaks for itself in a strong manner, which is unmistakable. When you take on the testimony that you are in Christ, it is backed up by the characteristics that he carried, and thankfulness is one he carried very well. My hope is that I would always be remembered by a few things. That I would be a good and faithful husband and father. That I could be a trusted pastor. That I am a generous person. And that I have a thankful spirit. Each of these I work at continually, and I know in those, a thankful spirit will actually speak to itself without action required. Yes, I will say thank you, but often you don't need to put words behind it because it will speak to itself. I can trust that this person is going to have gratitude towards my act because I know who they are. Because gratitude is its own testimony. Gratitude will be the substance of your testimony. That you don't just speak Jesus, you live him, and his character is alive inside you. That his nature is at work in and through you. That his life is speaking through your own, and it is empowered by the spirit of gratitude. Finally, this morning, gratitude will allow you to surrender a situation to God and seek his perspective. You ever been stuck in traffic for more than 5 minutes? We had a moment a little while ago, we were coming back from Heidi's parents, and the traffic was bad, and we knew, according to the GPS, that there was a traffic jam. And I had a chance to get off and drive around, but it would add 20 minutes to the drive. And I thought, well, how long is the traffic jam going to be? It's an accident. Oh, no, we could be there an hour, and I'd miss the turnoff. And I pulled up to where the traffic stopped, and one of those trucks passed us, that like the traffic control trucks. And within 2 minutes, we were past the accident. And so it probably delayed me about 6 minutes total, whereas the drive around would have been 20. So that was one of those moments where, like, thank you, Lord, that you guided us into a traffic jam. But have you ever been stuck in traffic that you, like, for 5 minutes or more? It gets really frustrating really, really fast, especially when you need to be somewhere 15 minutes ago. But perhaps you knew already that traffic was heavy because you take that route often and you know at 3:30 in the afternoon, traffic is insane and I need to leave early so I miss the traffic. And you still hit the traffic. And you get really frustrated really quick. And now the traffic is making everything worse. How do you handle that moment in thankfulness? Certainly you don't sit there and go, wow, God, thanks for the horrible timing on the traffic. I'm already late, but thanks for thinking about me. First of all, let me say, like, wow, if you're going to blame God for the traffic that you already knew was there, or if you're ever on the 401 and you think you're not going to hit traffic, and you blame God for it, there's probably a bigger issue in your life. When we come in that sense of thankfulness, it changes the situation. Try this next time. God, you know I'm really frustrated right now. But I want to say thank you that in my car, you are present and you are helping to change me into the person that you want me to be. You are speaking to me, you are loving me, and you are constantly developing me. And I invite you, Lord, to wait with me and change my heart in the way that I see things. This is honest to God. It exhibits that clear thankfulness and it guards you against the lies waiting at your door. Plus, as an added advantage, as people drive by and they're raging behind their wheel and they're waving their hands and screaming, and you're sitting there in peace looking out the window as God ministers to you, they're going to ask themselves, what's so different about them? I mean, they could say, what's wrong with that person? But the truth is, you know, you're at peace because you invited God to be a part of it and he's changing your perspective. Choosing to give thanks in all things will take all situations and surrender them to God. Then he will come and begin to show you the perspective that he has over that situation. And we invite him into that moment and process by extending gratitude to him. I'm going to invite the team to come back. I want to give you one final piece of advice. Make a habit or a pattern today of showing gratitude when things are going well. Choose to show thanks in all things when your health is good, when money is flowing, and when no one is against you. Because when you do this, when you give thanks when things are good, you will find that when things turn sour, as they will, that when things begin to go bad in your life and people rise up and somebody says something rude about you, or they leave you out, or you get overwhelmed by things, you will find that because you made a habit of being thankful in the good times, that in the bad times, you will find it easy to say, God, I thank you that you are here and you're going to show me something in the midst of this. Gratitude is a supernatural weapon in the hands of the believer. We need to choose today to begin to employ it and watch how it changes that battle that rages on in the heavenly realm. Join me as we pray. Father, I thank you for your heart for everyone in this place.
Thank you, Lord.
Father, I thank you that you have taught us well to be able to come in all situations and give thanks. But there is a process, Lord. It doesn't just come when something rises up, when someone's against us, when there's pain in our lives, when there's loss. To be able to stand there and say, God, I thank you for the loss in my life. That's not normal, I want to say. But there is an opportunity, Lord, to give thanks for what you're doing in the midst of that pain. To see your perspective that though we may live through that storm, and you won't necessarily take us around it or over it, you will guide us through it, and you will be there every step of the way. And so, Father, we bless you for that you are always near, that you are always providing, that you are always caring. Jesus, as we sing of your goodness here, of how great you are, pray, Father, that you would speak to each heart in this place. If there is anxiety rising up, let us give thanks for your presence so the peace of God will come. That goes above all human understanding, and it will fill us, and it will guard our hearts, and it will remove the anxiety that perhaps we've created. Not to diminish the sense of anxiety that is a situation, but God, you have the power for those moments that are stressful to fill us with peace, and it comes through our thankfulness. Teach us, Lord, how gratitude is a weapon to come against the principalities and powers that are at work in this dark world. Show us how giving thanks to you help us to win the war. In Jesus' name. Why don't you stand as we sing?
Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. And now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich because of what the Lord has done for us.
And now,
let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich because of what the Lord has done.
How great thou art.
clap offering this morning.
Hallelujah. We worship you.
So, Father, we close out simply by saying thank you. God, that it wouldn't just be a sense of because it's Thanksgiving, but it would echo through our lives every day. Father, teach us this practice of having gratitude and the power that it holds within us as we enact it every day. We bless you today, Lord. We bless each one that's here as they go and enjoy their weekend. In your name, amen. Thank you so much for joining us today. Hope you have a wonderful Thanksgiving Sunday and Monday, and enjoy the week as well. There's many things happening through the week. You can check online. When the emails come out this week, you'll see that as well. Have a blessed week.